invite everybody in the cafe and downstairs to come and start worship with us. We're going to start off our program today. My name is Claire Smith, and I'm going to be your MC. I'm so happy to be here with all of you to reconnect to God and reconnect with our true selves and our community. Without further ado, I'm going to transition to the band to kick us off. They're going to be singing two songs for us today, so I'd like to ask everybody to please stand so that we can worship together with the band.
We're going to slow it down a little bit, really worship God, bring God into our hearts. We're going to sing As the Deer.
Thank you so much, Ben. I'd like to ask everybody to join me in prayer. Dear Heavenly Parent, as we're gathered here together as a community, all coming from different walks of life, carrying different things within our lives, good experiences or bad experiences or breakthroughs or victories from this past year, I want to ask everybody to really offer up everything that happened this week back up to you so that we can reconnect with you with a clean and a pure and an open heart today. We're so grateful to be here, to have each other here, to have our families and to have our friends. And as the snow really covered everything this morning, it shows how beautiful it can be when we cover everything with love and when we cover everything with freshness and with a new perspective on the week. And we ask that not only can we walk with you this week, but we can make space intentionally in our life to be transformed with you, and that we can do something different, grow our heart, do a little bit more for someone that maybe we've been struggling with. Ask that we can have the strength to make you proud this week and this month as we start off this year centered on you.
I think each and every person, we're carrying something different in our hearts. And I hope that you can be with each and every person as they leave this church today after we close it up, and that we can really do our best to put love into action and be the best representatives of you. I ask that you can be with our global movement, not only in our community, but as there's incredible things going on, and that we can really continue to have faith in your magic, in your grace, and in the ways that you constantly work in each and every one of our lives. I want to report this prayer back up to you, not only in my name, but in everybody's name who have joined us here. Claire and Mitsu Smith, bless such a couple. Amen and adieu. So nice to see you all with fresh eyes after a beautiful prayer. I'm so grateful to be here. I thought the band did such a beautiful job to open it up, right? Aren't we so grateful for the band? Let's give them one more round of applause. They do such an incredible job at transforming the spirit. Now I'd like to do a quick activity with everybody here. When I was driving into church today, I listened to the radio. I love to learn things and listen to the news. But the radio person said something like, if anybody has something good going on in their lives, please call in and tell me something good. And so you had this compilation of about 10 different great stories and breakthroughs of people, little things, big things going on in their lives. And I know right now is our usual greeting time, but I'd like you to turn to your neighbor and not only greet them with a handshake or a hug, but tell them something good that's going on in your life so we can create such fantastic energy together. Is everybody open to that? Yeah? Awesome. All right, so I'm going to give you 5 minutes. So meet a couple new people, say hi to, you know, your friends and your family, and tell them something good that's happening in your life. Now we'd like to move forward with preparing for our sermon. So we're going to have a short offering song shortly, but I'd like to introduce a little bit more around what Pastor Mike's going to be talking about today. So as you know, we're doing our educational series of content, and this month we're focusing on dominion. And so Pastor Mike is going to be sharing a little bit more around how to gain dominion around your surroundings, and how to manifest your intention, and how you can really transform your surroundings to heighten the spiritual energy around you. So I'd like to invite the band back up to do the offer. Do we have an offering song? Is it recorded? Okay, I apologize. Yes, we're gonna have a recorded video. So I'd like everybody to move your attention towards the screen, and we're gonna have a short recorded video. So open your hearts and minds, and then Pastor Mike's gonna come on up and start off with the sermon. Thank you.
great to see you all again. Thank you for coming. So my sermon today is called Our Personal Environment. And as you know, we're starting off the series on the third blessing. And the third blessing is all about having dominion over all things. And I think Adonia did a really great job last week of talking about what does that even mean? You know, dominion, all things. Is it just nature? Is it, you know, what does it mean to dominate, you know? So that was really good. If you weren't here, you know, please, you know, you can watch the recording on our YouTube channel. One of the things that I thought about as I was preparing for the message today is that there have been many times in my life where I have gone to workshops, I have gone to seminars, I've heard really inspirational sermons, and I tried to take that experience home with me and really determined that I would make a new, fresh beginning in my life in some way. It wasn't always a spiritual thing. I remember one time I went to a seminar about finances, and I said, oh, I'm gonna, you know, restart my finances. I'm really gonna get that in order and things like that. But in reality is, many times when I look back on those experiences, these determinations or these ideas that I had were difficult to maintain. They were difficult to follow through with. Maybe I would go to a workshop or I'd go to a service and I'd hear a really inspirational message about God, and I would decide, you know, I'm really gonna try harder to, you know, center my life around God. I'm really gonna try harder to, you know, read more God's words or pray more in my life. But then I would often not actually make any other changes in my life, and then the habit that I had of not doing those things would eventually take over again. One of maybe the strongest experiences that I've had of this kind of thing is I did a program called STF. You saw it on the video today. It's called Generation Peace Academy now. But it was, I went on it for 2 years, and back then it looked very different. It was, you know, you really committed yourself for 2 years to a very kind of a strict religious lifestyle. And we go out and we would, you know, try to do fundraising and make money, and we would go out and try to meet people and try to teach them about the divine principle and God and all these things. And we got very little sleep, and there was a lot of praying, and it was a very kind of rigid life in some ways. But it was really nice because I'd never really done that before, and it was nice to just be away from school and friends and to some degree family, and just be in an environment where I could just focus all my energy, all my thoughts and effort into my relationship with God and into, that's weird. Let's try this again. And it wasn't an easy kind of life, but I felt really close to God in a lot of difficult times. And really just trying to better myself, become a better person, try to understand what is my relationship with God, what is my faith. And I can't see myself ever going back and doing that again, but I treasure that experience. It was really a treasure of my life. But when I came home, I went back to my family in Wyoming. My parents know very well. And went back to my old friends, went back to my old computer, and everything was waiting there for me at home when I returned. And none of the people that I was with on the program, none of that structure, that schedule, followed me back home except for what I kept with me. But it was very hard to keep that kind of a lifestyle with me when I started going back to college, and when I started hanging out with my friends again, and they hadn't changed. All they wanted to do was hang out and play video games and watch anime. And they were really happy with that. And I used to be really happy with that. But then when I went on the program, then I felt like, oh, you know, there's There's more that I want to do with my life than just play video games and watch anime and go to school. But I didn't know how to share that with anybody. I didn't know how to make that, do that just by myself. I didn't know how to really communicate that with my own family. And so eventually over time, I started to just adopt the ways of my environment. The same environment that I left. I really tried for a long time to, you know, get up early and read. You know, I read the Bible, I read the Divine Principle. I really tried to make a practice of praying, you know, every day, really taking that seriously. But eventually, over time, I started to ask myself, what am I even praying for? what am I working towards, you know, in my life? Because when I was on the program, I had all these ideals, like I wanted to be like a leader or like do this or like maybe be a missionary in another country or something like that. But then when I'm back home, you know, out in, you know, regular, you know, life, I lost sight of a lot of those things, and I felt no power to pray for those things or to even expect anything like that could happen in my life. And I reached a point where I really found myself to be in a rut. I had stopped doing a lot of the things that I, you know, determined to do when I came home, and I just found myself just doing things that didn't really make me happy. And I was killing time. You know, when I had free time, I would just try to fill it and doing things that I kind of enjoyed doing, like playing video games or, you know, going. One thing that I used to really enjoy doing a lot is going to thrift stores and buying used DVDs. It was a hobby of mine. I amassed a huge collection, probably like 500. It was crazy. And then I sold them all later on. But I found myself doing a lot of things that didn't really make me happy. And I realized that I was at a bit of a crossroads in my life. I still had these ideals. I still had a desire to live a bigger life. I wanted to do something for God. I knew that there was maybe a destiny out there that was bigger than the way I was living. But I didn't know what it was, and I didn't know how to get there. And so I tried prayer again. You know, I kind of gave that up for a while. I tried it again. I tried reaching out to God. God, you know, I think I did it for 40 days. I know that there's a bigger plan for my life. I don't know what it is, and I don't know how to get there. But I really felt that God heard my prayer at that time, because God provided an opportunity for me to change, to join another program and move to California. And I ended up doing the next 8 years of my life with, spending the rest, next year, 8 years of my life with them. And reflecting on this experience, it really reminded me of the power of your environment. I had a young man come to me a couple years ago, and he used to, you know, come to our services. And he told me that, you know, he loved the sermons. Like, he always got a lot of inspiration out of them. But then when he would go home, then he would lose the inspiration. It didn't match with his lifestyle, and he just felt like, what's the point? Why do I want to inflict that on myself, you know, week after week after week, right? Nobody does. Who would want that? And so if we have experiences over and over in our life where I get inspired, maybe you get inspired to make a change, to do something new, you know, uplift your life in some way, but then because of different reasons, maybe your environment doesn't support it, maybe it's not something that you really want or whatever, and it just doesn't happen, then you stop trying, you stop even caring, like, what's the point of even getting inspired in the first place if I can't make that happen in my actual life? And I felt really bad for this young man. I wanted to be able to do something for him. But I really feel like this is the essence of the sermon. The essence of the sermon today is talking about our environment. And so when you hear environment, some of you may think about like your home, right? or nature. You might think about like things like cleanliness and tidiness. You know, we've all heard the saying that, what is it? Cleanliness is close to godliness, right? Who hasn't heard that? Everybody's heard that saying. But the environment goes much more beyond that. I want to give an example, a small example that I experienced this week. On Friday, Adonia and I participated in the marriage course. It's the fourth or fifth week, I think. Something like that, fourth week. It's been a really great experience. And this week, the session was on forgiveness. And there was a part of the program where we needed to write something down for our spouse that we felt that we needed to be forgiven for, and something that we would like, what is it, them, we need to be forgiven for, and we'd like for them to know so that they can know what is like something that, that in a way that they had hurt you, your spouse had hurt you. And it was unexpected experience because I had to write something that I felt I had hurt my wife in some way, whether it was a long time ago, something small, something big, didn't matter so much, but just something I felt I had hurt her. And I was surprised that what I wrote wasn't anything like what she wrote. And I found out that that she had really been hurting because I had been making small, sarcastic comments to her. And when she brought that up, I was like, I don't know what you're talking about. I had no idea. And she had brought up an example from earlier that day. I had to try to remember, like, wow. I started to recognize, it's true. I've been making these small sarcastic comments. It's like, I'll give you an example. So we went to the grocery store, right? I hope this isn't boring for you guys. There's a point. We went to the grocery store and we bought some groceries, and she had bagged the groceries and put all these maple syrup bottles in one bag. And we got to the car and she's like, the bag is kind of heavy. And she's like, oh yeah, I should have double bagged this. It's a little precarious. And I said something like, oh, it's too late for that. And it was this kind of not an outright hurtful comment, but it was said in such a way that it was slightly sarcastic and slightly condescending. And I've been making these comments on a regular basis, especially if I'm not in a good mood, and not recognizing the effect that it's having on her, not recognizing that these comments are hurtful and that they are costing us a certain level of intimacy in our marriage. And when she told me that, it was a shock, but I recognized it and I said, you know, I decided that, you know, well, this explains a certain lack of intimacy there, you know? We had just been talking about, like, well, why is there a certain lack of intimacy, you know? And, but it really took the environment of this marriage course to bring out these things. They're not like something that you're gonna bring up in a casual conversation. And, but it was, and so I felt really grateful because, I mean, we would have eventually worked that out. It would have eventually come out in a conversation, probably after it got a lot worse. But I was grateful because in the safety of that environment, we could express something without fear that there was going to be a reaction, anger, or something like that. But that we could just share it in this environment and that it would help us to grow our relationship. It reminded me how often these kind of experiences have happened in my own life, where I felt that, you know, no matter how much I've tried to grow as a person just by praying and asking God for this and that, how often the answers have come through another person or through a circumstance. It was a reminder that God speaks to us through other people. And we may ask for the answers, but you know, we don't know how God is going to find a way to reach us. Many times we don't even want to listen to our own spouse. So it really helps to have these kind of things. And I thought, if we hadn't made that effort to sign up for the course, then we would have missed out on that opportunity. So our environment is much more than just our home. It's much more than just our car. Our environment is everything that we choose to surround ourselves with in our life. In a sense, you could call it like your atmosphere. And it's something that affects us, whether we recognize it or we want it to or not. These are the people in our lives, our friends, our family. If you're on the internet, this is social media. This is, you know, websites and emails and the books that we read, the kind of music that we listen to. There's a, I want to read this quote here. This is from the Bible. This is from Genesis. This is right after God gave the three blessings. He said, "Then God said, I give you every seed-bearing plant on the face of the whole earth and every tree that has fruit with seed in it. They will be yours for food, and to all the beasts of the earth and all the birds in the sky and all the creatures that move along the ground, everything that has the breath of life in it, I give every green plant for food." And it was so. Now the Lord God had planted a garden in the east, in Eden, and there he put the man he had formed. The Lord God made all kinds of trees grow out of the ground, trees that were pleasing to the eye and good for food. In the middle of the garden were the tree of life and the tree of knowledge of good and evil. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and take care of it. And the Lord God commanded the man, "You are free to eat from any tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, for when you eat from it, you will certainly die." Now, let's see here. Okay. When I was reading this, what struck me about this is that God created the environment for us as his children. When God was creating this universe for us, he was thinking about what is pleasing to the eye, what is tasteful, like what is delicious to eat. You know, creating an environment that is beautiful and beneficial for his children. He put a lot of effort, a lot of thought, and despite what many people believe, millions and millions of years of trial and error and building this world that we live in, because he wanted to create a beautiful environment for his children. And this is no different than any parent who is thinking about their children and thinking, how do I create a nice environment? How do I create a good something that will help my child to grow up into a wholesome person? It's really an aspect of God that I really believe that he instilled into each and every one of us. So, if God is going to make the effort to prepare an environment for us, then it's a lesson that we need to take to heart for ourselves. We can learn so much about life from our understanding of God. And then we can also learn a lot about life from nature. I love pulling from nature. So does everyone know what this bird is? Yes, it's a magpie. Thank you, Nancy. Our founder, Reverend Moon, actually talks about magpies quite a bit, if you didn't know. Here's a quote that he used in from his childhood. It is interesting to observe a magpie's behavior. When you see a magpie's nest, you can tell from which direction the wind will blow this year. If the wind will be from the east, magpie prepares by building its nest entrance to the west. No one teaches a magpie how to build its nest, but each one is a masterpiece made of twigs. You might think such a nest would leak when it rains, right? But as a final touch, the magpie plasters the inside of the nest with mud. This blocks the wind. Also, the magpie arranges the twigs to slope in one direction so that when it rains, the raindrops will flow outward rather than into the nest. The twigs are also arranged in layers to prevent rain from flowing into the nest. I wonder who taught the magpie such amazing workmanship. So even in nature, we can see the beauty of God's essence in the birds. How a magpie will build a nest for its young and put so much effort into preparing for the inevitable challenges to come. The rain, the wind, somehow they know how to prepare in such a way to block those things. But in our own lives, it's something that I feel like we can really reflect upon. How much effort do we make to prepare an environment that's conducive for our own spiritual health? How much effort do we make to make an environment that is healthy for our children, healthy for our families, healthy for one another? Many times I feel that when we take our environment as just, it is just what it is. You know, I live in the place that I live. Well, my kids are young, so there's naturally going to be a mess. You know, we make effort. We have desire to do things, but we don't always make the changes in our environment to support those things. When I came back from doing my program for 2 years, STF, my environment was the same as when I left. So it was very, very difficult to change my actual way of life and to transfer that way of life from where I was living in that lifestyle to my home environment. It really takes us being aware of our environment and also being willing to take the steps to make changes. Maybe you want to be a person that is grateful for life. Maybe you want to be an optimistic, altruistic, loving person, you know, kind of person, right? Like we all want to be. But maybe all of your friends are really negative. Maybe they just complain all the time. And when you're with them, instead of you affecting them to be more positive, maybe they're affecting you to be more gossipy or complaining or something like that, pessimistic about life. It's hard to change other people. And I'm not saying that if you have, you know, friends that aren't healthy, that you should get rid of them, but we have to look at our life and decide, well, what do I want? What do I want for my life? I could say that I want to read more God's words in the morning, but if I leave it in another room where it's really hard to get to, or let's say maybe a different example, let's say I want to wake up early in the morning, but I don't set my alarm. Yeah, you might get lucky. Have you heard of the KonMari method? Is Margo here? There she is, okay. Margo sent me this video. I had heard many years ago about this lady, this method called KonMari, but I had never looked into it. It's a method of tidiness and organization developed by a Japanese lady named Marie Kondo. And she shares about how, you may have heard about the method. What you do is you go to your belongings. Let's say, for example, you have a drawer of clothes, and you take each piece of clothes out, and you ask yourself, how does this make me feel? Do I love this piece of clothes? Does this make me feel inspired? Or does this make me feel kind of down when I touch it. And she said, if your item inspires you, then keep it. If it doesn't inspire you, then you say a quick thank you. Thank you for, you know, being a for being a part of my life. And then you dispose of it. You give it away, get rid of it somehow. And I thought there was something really meaningful about this, because when she talks about it, and maybe she talks about more in her book in a different way, but it's really about organizing your home, going through your clothes, going through your books, your papers, your toys, whatever your belongings are. But when I thought about it, I thought, actually, you could kind of look at your whole life that way. There's certain things you can't get rid of, right? You know, parents, children, things like that. But looking at the things in our life that are part of our environment and asking myself, does this help me to be the kind of person that I want to be? Does this inspire me to be a godly person? Does this inspire me to have the kind of habits that I want to have in my life? Or is this dragging me down? Is it pulling me down? Is it making it harder for me to live the kind of way I want to live? And then if it is inspiring us, then keep it. But if it's dragging you down, then it might be time to say thank you and let it go. There was an article I found really interesting. Let's see if I can find it here. 128 fitness centers are banning cable news from being shown in their TV screens. Did you guys see this? It was just like a week or two ago, a few weeks ago. And so the idea here is that in all of 128 of this fitness center chains, Lifetime Athletic, they have blocked mainstream news. And they said, the decision to remove the national cable network from news stations resulted from significant member feedback received over time and our commitment to provide family-oriented environments free of consistently negative or politically charged content. It is always our goal to meet the majority of members' expressed requests, and we believe this change is consistent with the desires of overall membership as well as our healthy way of life philosophy. I thought, how interesting. So their members literally over a course of time told this company that the news isn't inspiring to me. Actually, and some other people said, and not in this part of the article, but they said, I actually feel kind of depressed after I watch the news on TV. I've experienced that on my social media. I've had to clear out a ton of stuff from my social media because I've noticed that after I'm done scrolling through, I feel kind of depressed. And that's not the kind of life that I want to live. Another example, this is one of my favorite authors, Rick Warren. He wrote one of the top-selling books of all time, Purpose-Driven Life. He says, and he's talking about his church that he built from scratch. At Saddleback, we teach biblical convictions in every program, class, seminar, and message, but conviction is caught as much as it is taught. It spreads best through relationships. Conviction is contagious. People acquire it by being around other people who have it. This is a major reason we emphasize small groups as a part of our life development process. Close association with people of conviction will often have a greater influence than merely listening to a message delivered with conviction. I thought that was really awesome. This idea that if you're wondering how to get greater conviction in your life, the answer is very simple. You just gotta have to hang around people who are more convicted than you are. And then naturally, a lot of that's gonna rub off on you. It's kinda like if you wanna become good at a sport. You can practice, and you can practice, and you can practice, but you never know. You might be practicing the wrong way. And then before you know it, you have to unlearn the things that you learned. It's a lot quicker and faster to find a coach. And then you can learn from them. Here's another quote from our founder. When we consider the principles God used in the creation of heaven and earth, we see that he did not first make the central beings and then the environment for them. Rather, before he created human beings, God prepared an environment based on relationships. In order to create human beings, he first made soil, for example. He established the internal based on the external. Okay. So as much as I don't like to admit it, I've come to recognize that we have to pay attention to our environments. We have to pay attention to the kind of people we are hanging around. We have to pay attention to the kind of music we're listening to. We have to pay attention to the quality of our home experience. We have to pay attention to what kind of family experience am I providing for my children. We have to pay attention to all these things, because even though we know that we can change our environment with our own personal growth and development, that our environment also affects us in a very, very strong way. And when we make the effort to not just tell God that, oh, I'd like to change my life, I'd like to make my life better, or maybe asking God, you know, could you please fix this thing in my life? But when we show God that not only would I like to make things a little bit better, but also I'm willing to change the things in my environment, I'm willing to do whatever it takes. For me, I had to kind of, you know, when I came to a crossroads in my life, I had to pack up and move. I had to change my environment completely, because I knew that that was the opportunity that was presented to me in response to my prayers. But ideally, we get to a point in our life where we are the masters of our environment, where we are owning our environment, where we can recognize, this thing is not healthy for me, this is not healthy for me, this is good for me. I want more of that and I want less of that. And to make the changes that we need to make. And I believe that if we do that and we ask God for things, then he's going to take us a lot more seriously, because we're going to show him that we're willing to not just ask for things or to pray, but we're also willing to do whatever it takes to make those things happen. So that's my message for today. Thank you, and please join me in prayer. Good morning. Good morning, Heavenly Parent. We're so grateful to be here. I was really moved by the songs this morning. I know, Heavenly Parent, that each and every one of us here longs for a personal relationship with you. We want to be close to you, Heavenly Parent. And it helps so much to recognize how much you have invested into each and every one of us, how much you care about each and every one of our circumstances. There's some things that we just can't control. They're not things that we have a say in. But it's so inspiring to just get a glimpse of how much you love each and every single one of us, how much you invested with a thought and a hope and vision for each and every one of our lives, that you could see us here today, that we would be here today together. I pray, Heavenly Parent, that each and every one of us, we can really come to a place, Heavenly Parent, recognize what we want in our life, and that we can really practice what it means to have dominion over our environment. If there's something in my life that is holding me back from being the kind of person that you want us to be, Heavenly Parent, each and every single one of us, Heavenly Parent, I pray that we can have the strength to move those things out of the way. Heavenly Parent, none of us wants to live hiding behind a rock, hiding behind excuses, hiding behind failed hopes and dreams. Every single one of us, Heavenly Parent, has dreams and inspirations and aspirations. Even if we thought we gave up on them many years ago, we still want them. I pray that we can rekindle that desire in each and every single person, Heavenly Parent. That kindling that you have put there in each and every one of our hearts, that we are the co-creators with you. That we are meant in our life to create something meaningful and powerful and something that we can bring to you as children, as your children, and offer our life work, Heavenly Parent. And I pray that each and every one of us can seek for that and find that. And when we find it, we move whatever barriers are in the way to create, to be able to create it, to have that environment that we can make that happen. Maybe we want our kids to grow up a certain way. There's a lot of obstacles in that way in our world. Nobody's going to teach our kids about God. No one's going to teach our kids how to live a godly life. But we can do it, and we can work together to do it. And we're grateful, Heavenly Parent. We have so many blessings. And I thank you. I thank you for every brother and sister that's here, and even these microphones that don't work very well. I offer this prayer in the name of Michael Adonai Hendrick. Blessings to your family. Amen. And I do. Thank you so much, everybody.
Thank you, Pastor Mike, for sharing so deeply. And I love that point that you make about becoming co-creators with God, right? Creating the foundation externally and internally for God to be able to come and work. Let's give him one more round of applause. So now we're going to be having our offering time. We have our ushers in the back who's going to be walking down the center aisle with the baskets, and now's your time to give your tithe and your offering. We're also going to be playing some background music as a moment of reflection for all that you heard today. So please join me in that. So I heard a couple of great stories from people that I connected with. One was talking about an incredibly generous customer. You'll have to get the backstory from her in the front row. Additionally, I heard just a little victory. Young Gil's daughter, she got her brand new room for herself, and she slept in it successfully last night, right? So it's the little things. So congrats to her, and I would love to hear all of your stories maybe later on, you know, after church downstairs in the fellowship hall. I want to see and I want to welcome if there's any new guests here. We try to be very intentional about welcoming, you know, new or returning guests to our community. So if there's any new guests, now would be your time to stand up, and we'd love to hear a little bit about yourself. You could introduce yourself. And if not, if you're feeling a little shy, no problem at all. We have a welcoming committee in the back that they have a little welcome packet for you and a little welcome gift bag, so you could learn a little bit more about us, and most importantly, so we can learn a little bit more about you. So welcome to all the new people or returning guests within our audience. We also have a fellowship downstairs. Typically afterwards, we have a full lunch provided, and we're more than happy to have you join us so we can learn a little bit more about yourself. All right, so we're gonna transition now to our announcements. We're first gonna have our national announcements, and then we'll release all the youth to Sunday school, and then we'll do our local announcements. So let's kick it off with the national announcements that give a quick recap of everything that's been happening in our movement on the national front this past week.
Hi, this is Karen with your weekly update. Let's start with some news from Korea. Following the Africa Summit 2018, a victory celebration was held where True Mother spoke about the event and the future of Africa.
Africa. 고대 아프리카 어원에서부터 나온 말은 Mother of Land. 그리고 아프리카는 빛이라는 뜻이 있다고 그래요. 아프리카는 하늘 선미에 있어서 준비된 어머니와 하나 된 아프리카. 이번 세네갈에서 4박 5일 역사적인 대회를 했어요. 이곳으로 끝나고 그냥 지나갈 수는 없어요. 이제 밭을 갈았으니 씨앗을 뿌리고 뿌리를 내려야 돼. 아프리카 대륙의 모든 중심 역할을 할 수 있는 본부를 이곳 세네갈에 두기로 결심했습니다.
7-day Japanese American workshop here in Las Vegas, and we're so grateful that Reverend Tokuno from Japan could send Reverend Kashi here from Japan to give us these wonderful lectures. We were so touched by his presentation on True Parents Life course.
We just had a leadership meeting with all of our American lecture and education team, first and second generation, and we had a really great afternoon time with Reverend Kashi that came all the way from Japan to teach us True Parents course. Everybody is moved to tears. Everybody feels that how could we possibly be a filial child without really understanding True Parents course?
I think that's actually been the biggest change this time, this workshop, than ever before, is that I'm studying Divine Principle as a parent.
I'm filled with so much gratitude and at the same time repentance too for my own lack of understanding.
Thank you so much for sending us these wonderful lectures to really inspire us and to get us going for the next stage of our Vision 2020 progress.
Reverend Kashi shared with us about True Father's course in prison, his incredible sacrifice of his family, of his physical body. This is such an amazing content, and I strongly believe that if we can convey this content clearly to our members, to our second generation, to the world, that they will realize how deeply they've been loved by our true parents. So this has been an incredible experience, and I want to encourage everyone to come to IPEC and to get this kind of experience for your own life of faith. Thank you very much.
On January 27th, the 22nd True Family Values Awards Banquet was held in Chicago, where the American chapter of the Interreligious Association for Peace and Development, IAPD, was inaugurated. Leaders from major faith traditions signed a resolution calling us to a higher understanding that we are all created by the same one God, that we should work together to strengthen families and lead the world to peace.
Over 400 religious leaders and brothers and sisters from our family church, we celebrate centering on heavenly parents, centering on true parents.
The signing of this new movement touched my heart. And as long as we stay together and tear down walls and build bridges of love, I am convinced that today sparks a brand new tomorrow.
We talked about so many things, primarily the family and how it's necessary for us to continue to love each other as Mother and Father Moon has taught us. That is the only way we are going to arrive at peace.
I've learned from Father Moon that we are indeed the children of God, and God is our heavenly parents.
What is the fundamental value of our human being? None other than true family value. This is God's principle of creation, and this age, true parents dedicated their whole life for the sake of build God's ideal family.
Also in Chicago, Reverend David Rendell was inaugurated as the new leader of Subregion 3 during the Chicago Church's Sunday service. Dr. Kim was there to congratulate him along with his family and church community.
I just wanted to say that our family is really grateful for everything that True Parents have given to us, and we'd like to be servants for our region and just be able to serve our True Parents as well.
Thank you, sisters and brothers throughout the Chicago, throughout the Midwest, and throughout that sub-region number 3. God bless you.
Hi, my name's Jan Pearson. I'm one of the current staff members on GPA. And for all you high school and college students, I'd like to talk to you about the opportunity of taking a gap year with GPA. Here are some reasons why I think GPA could be a great option for you. The first is that GPA gives you an opportunity to dive deeper into our faith's teachings and figure out what they mean to you. And second, GPA gives you the opportunity to make friends and meet people in our faith community from all over the world. And third, GPA gives you the time to work on yourself, develop your character, and become a more mature person for all the things you're gonna do after GPA. I went through this program, and I can tell you one of the things that I gained was a strong desire to not only go to college, but to excel in college. Another point is that GPA helped me to clarify who I am as a second generation and what I believe in. Oh, another thing, most of my best friends, even to this day, are people that I met on the program. One of those is my wife. For more information or to apply, go to our website at generationpeaceacademy.org.
Registration is now live for the February 7-day and March weekend Divine Principle Retreats at IPEC. Don't miss this invaluable opportunity to immerse yourself in the principle. Visit familyfed.org/dpretreats to learn more and register.
Hi everyone, Richard Busing here. I just wanted to say that the holiday season is coming up. Now, I don't mean the traditional holiday season as we know it, like Thanksgiving and Christmas, but our holiday season. You know, True Parents Birthday, Foundation Day, Happy Parents Day. So this is a special time of the year when we're having a lot of very special events that are going to be taking place, not only in Korea, but all over the world. And this is our chance, like Christmas, when we give a lot, when the world spends a lot to honor the birthday of Jesus, we are going to honor the birthday of our true parents. So this is a chance I would like to encourage all of you to make an offering, to give joy and happiness to our true parents, and give the best that you can for this time, and make this a special holiday in our church. You can just go to familyfed.org. All the information is there to make your contribution for these special holidays. Thank you all very much.
That's all for now. Thanks for watching. God bless, and see you next week.
So great to get further insight around what's going on so that we can pray and obviously support that with good energy. I'd like to now release all the youth to Sunday school. You're officially dismissed. So everybody who's going to Sunday school, now is your time. And we're going to be sharing a couple of local announcements here, so I'll kick it off. The first, as we know, the Super Bowl is going on today, and the church is so gratefully going to be hosting a Super Bowl party today, starting at 4 o'clock in conjunction with Young Adult Ministry. So the game officially starts at 4:30 Mountain Standard Time today, but the party starts at 4, so we want to welcome everybody to come out and celebrate together, you know, reconnect with friends and family. And if you'd like to also stay further, you're welcome to do so. So that's going to be here today downstairs, or I think it's going to be right here, yeah, in a couple hours. So we all ask for you to come out and have a little fun with us. Additionally, we're so lucky to have a representative from the local library just right down the street. The Corky Gonzalez Library is sending a representative. Her name is Nadia Rendon, and she'll be here today during lunchtime. She's setting up a table below downstairs to share more about resources and free programs and family resources that you can take advantage of. So, you know, make sure to say hi to her and learn a little bit more around the free programs and things going on in our local community that you can plug into and take advantage of. We have a couple of holy days that Pastor Mike is here to share a little bit more about, so I'm going to jump off stage and he's going to share a little bit more around the holy days. So let's welcome him up.
Thanks, Lara. So as you know, every year around this time we celebrate our church's holy days, and these are really special days for us because they're not necessarily celebrated by everybody in the world, but they are our time of the year to really celebrate our Heavenly Parent, God, to celebrate also our Founder's birthday. And we will be having on these days, which I believe is a Friday, Wednesday, and Wednesday, we will be having a prayer and pledge service here at 7 a.m. So you're all invited to come. You know, bring your kids. It's a great way for our kids to, you know, have a meaningful experience around these holy days. And also, it's fun for them to be able to participate in the offering table with all the fruits and the treats and things like that. Our kids always look forward to it. And if you're also able to help out in any way with cooking breakfast or helping to cook breakfast or helping with the offering table setup, those things would be really welcome as well. And on the 25th, which is a Sunday of this month, we'll be having a celebration here. And we're still working out exactly what we're going to be doing for the celebration, but a couple of the things that we've talked about doing are, for example, we'd love to have a presentation about the life of our founders, Reverend and Mrs. Moo. We're going to have a presentation about what their life has been like and how they've brought the movement to where it is today and all the things that they had to go through in order to make that happen. And this will be something that you can invite your friends to. You know, if they were to come to church that day, they could stay for it because it's made for everybody. And we're, you know, of course, thinking about fun things to do with the kids. And it's going to be a potluck that day. So, you know, our potlucks have been pretty awesome. But it's a special day, so even maybe you could think of even something a little bit more special to bring. So that's all I have to say. Thank you so much. And there'll be email going out about it as well.
Thank you, Pastor Mike. Appreciate it. Another thing is that there's a romantic couples getaway to a local destination, which is an ice skating rink up in Evergreen in the mountains there on February 17th at 3 p.m. So you and your special someone can enjoy an ice skating trip in the scenic Colorado, just about 40 minutes west from downtown Denver. So we encourage you to leave the kids at home and share this special time with your spouse. There's drinks for sale at the lodge, and there's a big fire to stay warm around, and the admission cost is $7 per person, and skate rentals are additional $7. So pretty affordable for a great small getaway to do something different and mix it up for the month of February. So this is something you can put in your calendars and look forward to February 17th at 3 p.m. Additionally, as mentioned in the National Highlights video, there's going to be upcoming Divine Principle workshops at the IPEC Center in Las Vegas, and these are the upcoming dates. As you can see, there's some coming up as soon as the end of this month and in March and April as well. And if you're interested in attending and need some more support, we encourage you to talk to the pastors to learn more about how you can make this happen. Another thing going on is we want to always be grateful and thankful for our local community members who cook. And next week, the Mahardy family is going to be cooking and cleaning to make the fellowship and lunch possible afterwards. So let's take a moment to thank them for their service and putting their faith into action. So if you see them, give them a nice hug or high five to appreciate them for their work next week. The next thing I want to share is we have two special Japanese sisters from our local community who are going to be sharing a little bit about their experiences at the Japanese IPEC DP workshop. So if the two sisters are here, I'd like to welcome them up so that they can give short testimony on their experience and we can learn a little bit more about that. So it's one brother as well. All right, let's welcome them up.
Good morning, everyone. First of all, I really want to thank you to everyone who support and play for us. as a Japanese member, I can say it's difficult to find a time or chance to have lecture in Japanese. And learning those things in Japanese, own language, is very important for us, I think. Because deeply you can feel the vibration of true parents and heavenly parents. And of course, I'm here and I can speak English, but still somehow I was wanting something that I feel I still connect to God, I still connect to true parents. But just reading fundoke or prayer is not enough for me. So this time I really appreciate this opportunity. There is some pictures. I didn't prepare a lot of pictures, but I just want to share the atmosphere. We went to the trip, the Fuba Dam. That was the picture on the bridge. And this is like group meeting, like lunchtime or dinner time. And you can share what you feel or in your lifetime, also what you learn from the lectures. So like we have a lot of, we actually didn't have enough time to share, but I actually enjoyed each time. And then you can go ahead. This random picture that on the bridge of Fuba Dam. It's two father actually went to condition close to this Fuba Dam. I think the name was Lake Mida or something like that. And next. And then it's underground of Fuba Dam. And this is Red Rock Canyon. I personally thought we can go Grand Canyon, but I didn't know they close on winter time. But actually really enjoy the beautiful mountains that as you know, we have a beautiful Colorado. But yes. Yes, you can. This is how everyone who attend this time. So this time on 70 Japanese members and 20 leaders who mainly come from headquarters. And this is Mr. Nakamura having lecture. And relax time, giving massage each other. And we also have a choir. Before starting the lecture, we have a choir, and I really I did volunteer this time, and I really appreciate the Denver choir too, because it's bringing up a nice spiritual atmosphere. So it's good to experience this time, and the prayer time. Yes, we shared a testimony each other. I think this time was very packed because so many things Mr. Nakamura and Mr. Kachi wanted to share. So we woke up early in the morning and end up like 9 or 10 o'clock. But each time we spent was really worth it. Personally, I hesitate to go bathroom and, maybe someone is cheering right now. I don't want to waste time. So I really enjoyed it. And also, like, we went to Chonwa-gun, which two parents were living here and having a lot of condition. And there are several nice pictures. Yes, I think the picture was it. I just wanted to share one thing. This is the IPEC Center at night. I just picked up from internet, but I thought it's very beautiful. This, how many people visit here? Not yet, yeah. Oh, right. I think first time I heard IPEC, I thought, it's workshop place, so we learn a lot of things, and it's like champion. Oh, okay, do we have bed or something like? But it's very like a hotel. Like they treat us like a VIP. So I really enjoyed it from bottom of heart. And the one thing I really want to share was at the opening ceremony, Reverend Busing was sharing that. About one testimony about true father. So one one member's father was passed away just recently. I mean, recently, so this member's true father know about it. So true father asked him, so how's your life after your father passed away, went spiritual world? And he was really crying and, oh, it's so hard. Without him, I cannot do anything. And he shared the emotional feeling to true father, and true father told him, well, if you don't know two parents very well, then it's difficult. But if you deeply know two parents and having parents, it's you don't need to struggle that much. And at the opening ceremony, he shared this story, and I was keep wondering what that meaning. And personally, I got it like this. Personally, I here and watching Peace TV and watching two parents of what she's doing in the world, but I didn't feel connected with her, honestly. Like, I wanted to do something for her, but it's because something that I need to do as church member, but it was not from bottom of heart that I wanted to do something. And recently, we hear Hyojong, the word, and I think the Hyojong meaning have a lot of meaning, so it's difficult to explain in a word, one word, but what I get this time was the true connection with two parents and having parents, which think about own actual parents, your father and mother, even they're in a different state or spiritual world, but you always wonder what they are doing, what care about them. And I think that's the connection. That's that we need to have this kind of emotional connection with two parents and having parents too. So I was really refreshed by these lectures because Mr. Nakamura and Mr. Kachi was really showing that, especially Mr. Kachi was really sounds like true parent, true father, and acting like true father, jumping from this stage and shaking Okada-san. He was sitting in front of him, and he was like this. But I think when I see that, oh, true father was like that, and I almost forgot that how true father act and how he talk long time. But this time, what I can say is really remind myself how true father love us and how I need to remind myself. So yeah, I experience a lot of emotional, spiritual experience. So it's not enough time, but just I really wanna say thank you for everyone to supporting, financially supporting, watching children and play for us. Thank you very much.
Good morning. I wasn't prepared like her because I was just told 5 minutes ago to say something. So. So anyway, first of all, we are very grateful for all the Denver Church support, especially finance support for this. And this workshop has been already a fifth time. So even with the first one, I really wanted to go last year, but because of some different time schedules, I couldn't go. So, but. Yeah, this one, those two lecturers are really like both of them, I think 50 years, they are lecturing 50 years, and then that's why the very content is so deep and and especially why Yeonjinim, the father's son, Yeonjinim, all those in father's two parents, two families' history, how there's a helicopter collapse, and those accidents, everything there is a meaning. And then all those, exactly that there is showing the diagram and how we haven't, as a blessed family, fulfilled our responsibility of the tribal messiah, the home church and tribal messiah, is all those same category. And then, so if you heard those kind of lecture, you can see the so clear, everything, you know, understanding so clear. And also about, there's a, one of the lecturer also, he showed that there's a acceptance of a true father in a, maybe X, what we call X, and then Y like this is a, maybe a X, and the acceptance of a true mother. So the, you know, all different group or the schism come, is in both section, you know. And then, so the Orthodox mainstream is a, you know, acceptance of true father and the true mother, both you know, this realm, the Orthodox or mainstream in unification. So anyway, there are so many contents. Is very incredible content, and then I was very grateful. And then Damien, who is the vice president of our movement, he was at the end, he was saying, you know, this content, you know, immediately every blessed central family in America, they have to listen this one. So anyway, this was all recorded. So I don't know how their people distribute those DVD or something. I think when they are available, people say should really grab those. And then you can see when you read it or when you heard, it's very, you know, so clear for all the, you know, why there's so many, you know, all those things. Everything is also clear. So he was saying, and then also, and then at the time, the Vice President Damien was saying, also there is a website, heavenlytribe.org, how to register. And he was showing at the end that there's all those victorious couple of who have accomplished 430 families. And there are so many, already I heard 12 couples in America have gained victory. And then they show in that heavenlytribe.org, they all question, typical question and answer, how to re-educate after the blessing, and all those things is in that heavenlytribe.org. So I think this was very good because of all the important lecture, they heard all this lecture, so it was, I think this is really great, you know, from now on, I think great development will occur, I'm sure. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for sharing so deeply, and we're so happy to hear that you've had such an incredible experience. I think we're all definitely inspired to go check out IPEC ourselves.